here. I'm a poor substitute. Brother Corey's out today. He was a little under the weather. I said, man, better safe than sorry. Y'all stay home. I'll be your in-flight steward. But no, we're so glad you're here. Want to make a few quick announcements this morning. There will be no church council meeting this afternoon because of Corey's out. We'll postpone that and let you know when they'll be rescheduled. Also, next Sunday, we're going to do a little fun. For those that feel comfortable with this, we're going to have a church-wide picnic and softball game at Shopville Park. It's a nice facility. It will be kind of a COVID-friendly. We still encourage people to wear their mask. The food, we're having IGA chicken tenders and mac and cheese, green beans, mashed potatoes, all individually served. So you can get your stuff, kind of get to your people, your little area. If you bring your own chair and kind of sit away that you feel comfortable with, that's perfectly fine. And immediately following that, we're going to play some softball. If you don't play, come and laugh at us. A lot of prayer. But thought it'd be kind of fun. I was watching, I think Maddox play a ball game. I looked at Darren and said, "Man, we should have a church league game." He goes, "I think we'd probably have enough to play." So even if you think, "Oh, I don't know," we'll find a spot to put you, and we'll have some good clean fun. So just want to kind of get together and have some fun. So put that on your calendar. They'll be at 12:30 at Shopville Park, and you can trickle in if it's going to take you. Get dressed. Don't worry about being late. We'll kind of all kind of converge when we get there. I'm excited. Yes, before you ask, somebody in here is wondering, Brother Danny, did you know you have to reserve those? And it's reserved and paid for, and we're all good to go. So weather permitting, we should have a good clean fun next week. So thank you for being here. If you would if you would stand and join us this morning in worship.
Good morning. I'm glad to see you guys this morning. Let's do something we haven't done in a while. Just turn, say hi to your neighbor without walking around. Maybe like stare at them awkwardly, see what kind of face you think they're making under their mask. This morning, Danny is going to be preaching on the who, not the do. And so we're going to be talking about the person of Christ. And this morning, I just wanted to sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus, because he is our great friend, and then he knows my name. Two songs that just really speak to the relationship that we have with Christ as a friend and as a brother. So lift your voices this morning. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. I need this pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be. Our every weakness, take it to the Lord in prayer. Our maker. He formed my heart before even time began. My life was in his hands. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. I have a Father. He calls me his own. He'll never leave me, no matter where I go. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. Thank you so much for this morning and for giving us the opportunity to meet together and to worship you together. Father, I just pray that through this service you could be glorified, that our hearts would be focused on you, that we would hear the message that you have given Danny to bring to us about your son and about the person of Jesus Christ. Father, I just thank you so much. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys can be seated. We have a special treat this morning. Herman and Don and Reese are going to sing a special for us this morning, so let's enjoy that.
There's a lighthouse on a hillside that overlooks life's sea. When I'm tossed about, it sends out a light that I might see. And the light that shines in darkness now will if it wasn't for the lighthouse, my ship would sail no more. And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to him, for Jesus is the lighthouse. There's no use in it standing ground. that stormy night when just in time I saw the light, yes, the light from that old lighthouse that stands up there on a hill. And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to Him. For Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin He has shone the light around me, that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, where would this ship be? And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to Him. For Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin He has shone a light around me, that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, where would this ship be?
Jeez. Is that the right key?
I'm finding it. I'm trying. Yeah, y'all come on. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong. They are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Good morning.
I was thinking about this week when I played little league baseball. That was a moment in my career that I learned a valuable lesson. I got a big hit to right field, and it went way out there. And I'm running to first, and I see Larry Dobson get the ball. I played with Larry since we were little bitty kids, and I knew Larry had a good arm. And although my coach was doing this number. You know what that means? Keep running. And I rounded first and slowed down to a trot, and I was watching him, and sure enough, he got the ball, and I went walking back to the first base. CJ is cringing somewhere. But anyway, I remember my coach, because you probably can't do that these days, especially with Corona, but I remember him grabbing me I had a little mask thing on my helmet. He said, "Roland, what did I tell you?" I said, "He had the ball." He said, no, I'm the coach. I know what's going on. I sent you. You don't look. You run with everything you've got. Do you understand? Yes, sir. But, no, but, if you get out, it's on me. It's on me. You do what I say. Yes, sir? I said, yes, sir. So, sure enough, as it would happen, about the eighth inning, I'm out there. Same pitch, same hit. Same guy in right field. I see Larry coming up with a ball, and I hit first, and that coach was waving me, and I just put my head down. I ran as hard as I could, and I got to second base, and they were standing there with the ball. and they slapped me out. I remember the huff, and I turned around walking to the dugout, and my coach grabbed me by the same mask. He said, "Great job, great job." I go, "I got out." He goes, "We got to run. There was somebody on third base. I wanted them to throw it to second and try to get you out so we could get a, there's another point on the scoreboard today. It's RBI because you listened to me. Great job." And I remember going, "Oh." I don't remember the score of that game, but I'll never forget my coach's reaction. I'll never forget the look on his face when I listened to him and did exactly what he said. And I think that applies to our life. My Bible's behind you. Thank you. But I couldn't help but think how awesome. There's so many Bible stories about men and women in the Bibles that just said, "You know what? I don't have a backup plan. God, you said to do it. I'm going to do it." And I love this passage in Daniel chapter 3. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were three friends. It's funny names, right? But they were three friends, and the king Nebuchadnezzar said, "I'm going to build this golden statue. It's going to be 9 foot wide," which is almost as wide as that opening there, but it's 90 feet tall. This ceiling is about 30 foot high. Me and Mr. Chris have been up there a few times. So it's three times as tall as the ceiling. It's huge golden statue. And the king says, every time that the horn and the zither and all those things play, then I want everybody to bow down. And these three guys said, "We're not doing it. We've been listening to God, and God says, I want you to obey, I want you to obey, I want you to obey, and we're not going to bow down." And when they were called in by the king, and the king looks at them and he points their finger and gets really mad, he says, matter of fact, let me back up and read that part. It says, "Furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, 'Is this true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold set up before me?' And when they heard that," he said, "when you hear the sound of the horn, the zither, the harp, the pipes, and all kinds of musical instruments, if you are ready to fall down and worship the image I have made, very good for you. But if you do not worship, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand?" And I love the response. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, "O King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O King. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O King, that we will not serve your God." I love that. I love that they are strong enough to go, "You know what? I may get thrown out at second. This may blow up my face, but I'm going to do exactly what my coach says because I'm not playing for the scoreboard. I'm playing for my coach, and his name is Jesus. I'm playing to make God smile, not the world, not anybody else. I'm just here to make God smile. And when coach says run, I run. When coach says do something, I do it. It may not make much sense to the world around me. People may go, 'I can't believe you're doing that.' He said, 'I need you to be clear. I'm not doing it for you. I'm doing it to make my coach smile.' And what he says matters more than anything. And I just need you to know, win or lose, I'm going to listen to my coach." So let's pray and ask God to help us with that today, because sometimes that's hard. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for loving us. Father, help us. God, as the world is difficult sometimes to know what to do. But Father, I pray that you help us be bold. Help us to listen to you. And as you wave us on, as you give us instructions, may we go full speed ahead and say, "I don't have a backup plan. My plan is Jesus and to make him smile." And the world may say, "That doesn't make sense. You'll never make money that way. You'll never be happy that way. I may even die on this hill, but you know what? I'd rather die with Jesus
than to live with the world. Father, thank you for your security. Thank you for your promise. Thank you for being a good God. I love you, God. In your name, everybody said, amen. Miss Sydney's going to take y'all upstairs.
And again with us this morning. For our offering time, you can go online and give at phbcsomerset.com/giving. Or there's donation boxes in the back right here at this store and at the sanctuary. So if you want to give financially, that's how you can do that. In Hebrews chapter 6, it says, "We who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever." And like Danny was talking about, Jesus being our coach, he is our high priest. He has gone before us. He knows the big picture. He knows what's happening. He has already paid the price for our sins. And when we're playing on his team, all we got to do is listen to him and follow his spirit. And this morning, as we sing Christ the Sure and Steady Anchor, whatever storm we're in, whatever's happening in our lives, if we just hold fast to the anchor, it will never be removed because he is eternal. Christ the sure and steady anchor in the fury of the storm. My sins have all been torn in the suffering, in the sorrow, when my sinking hopes are few.
Midnight, I have all in my face.
all the storms howl above me, and there's no hiding place in the crash of the thunder. Precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand, and keep me safe till the storm passes by. Many times Satan whispered, there is no use to try, for there's no end of sorrow, there's no hope by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow I'll rise where the storms never darken the skies. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand, keep me safe till the storm passes by. When the long night has ended and the storms come no more, let me stand in thy presence on that bright, peaceful shore, in that land where the tempest never comes. Lord, may I dwell with thee when the storm passes by. Till the storm passes on, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand, and keep me safe till the storm passes by. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand, and keep me safe till the storm passes by. And keep me safe till the storm passes by.
God, thank you again so much for today. I just pray that as Danny comes, that you would open our hearts, open our minds to listen to your word, that we could apply it and take it home, and that your word would become part of us, that we might look more like Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dale. Bless my heart. I had the privilege to do some traveling this past weekend. I did a wedding back in Tennessee, and I'm road weary, y'all. Just under 900 miles in 3 days. If you drive that far, you should see a beach. Can I get amen? Amen. You should see some ocean and some water. But it was a precious moment to watch two families join. And I almost choked up as they walk in and we're getting ready. And I'm watching people line up and little ones run and throw in the little pillow that's supposed to hold the wing and watch the little kids together. And it was precious. It was precious. And one of the bridesmaids was one of our deacons' wives. And she is expecting child number two. And she was great with child. And I had this moment. I thought, someday she's going to be looking through pictures. And a little voice is going to say, Mama, where am I in this picture? So you were in Mama's belly right then. You know, and that means that Uncle so-and-so is going to be on their 13th or their 10th or whatever anniversary. So a lot of memories, a lot of neat things to watch that. But we are so blessed to be together today. Together is a good word. It's a wonderful, wonderful word. And I want to read, if you're taking notes this morning, today's title of the sermon is called Good, Better, Best. Good, Better, Best. But first, I want to talk about what's good. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. Can I get an amen? It is good. And as I talked to people and everybody was given their different situations, and those that are joining us online, thank you so much for joining today. And we are praying for you. We're looking for the day that we can all be together and hug necks and shake hands. And I'm looking forward to that day. It may be farther than we want. I'm looking forward to that. And if not in this world, the next, amen, there will be a day that we won't be wearing masks and taking those precautions. But until then, we're as smart as we possibly can. We've worked hard, by the way, here at Pleasant Hill, working hard, trying to be wise. You can watch online. You can watch it in Sunday school room. You can watch in the sanctuary. You can watch in the cry room. You can stay afterwards and do a virtual Sunday school classroom. We've worked hard at just trying to be smart. There's ways to check your temperature as you walk through the door. We offer masks. We do all kinds of things to do make it possible. We've been very blessed so far just to be healthy and be good. So we want to take a moment and be grateful for that. But we love you, and I'm so thankful. Matter of fact, this past weekend, I had to reel it in as I'm talking to former church members, not to sound like I was bragging, but I was bragging on you. And I thought for a moment, I don't want to do what my parents did. I have wonderful, man, it was funny. I watched my mom. I always got to be with my mom this weekend, and I watched her be with us. And when she was with me and my sister, she bragged on the other sisters. And I'd pull one sister aside and say, by the way, when you're not here, she brags on you too. When she's of that generation, you don't brag on kids in front of them, they'll get the big head, right? So we didn't hear a lot of sweetness growing up, but we had to remind each other that yes, you know, they are proud of us and this and that. It's kind of funny. But I wanted to brag on you because as I met with people of former churches, I got to see different people along the way. And I met Miss Frankie. Miss Frankie's 89 years old. She was mowing her yard. And she said, Brother Danny, I can only do section by section, but I get it done. Precious people. And I'm sitting out in this beautiful, God gave beautiful weather, so we could sit out and kind of give each other some space and just I want to hug you, Miss Frankie. Real sweet lady. But as I share stories about you and how loving you've been to me and my family and how precious this church is, I had to kind of reel it in because I watched them go, like, you don't miss us? No, y'all are precious. I miss y'all, and they're sweet people. But they would ask, how are you doing? And I felt like I was bragging, but I want to brag on you. Thank you so much. We've gotten through our first year here, and you have been precious to me and my family. I want to say thank you. Together has been good with you. And I pray that we have many, many, many more years. My mom keeps saying, so when you coming back? I said, Mom, don't hold your breath. She said, you really like Kentucky? I love Kentucky, Mom. This is God's country, amen? Amen. So I want to read, here we are in Matthew 17. I love this passage. I love that Jesus has the crowds that he ministers to. He has the 12 that he's ministering with. And then he has his three, his inner circle. And in this point in Jesus' life, it's almost like the three that he's closest to is not quite enough. He has to go visit some old friends like I did. He has to go see some old friends
that had a little more perspective on his life. And we have in this story in Matthew 17, the transfiguration, where he takes his inner circle up on the mountain, and he's going to pull some people from the past that he spent years with in paradise. But we're going to read here. It says, after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as the light. Just then appeared before them two old friends, Moses and Elijah, talking with Jesus. While he was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice... Is that right? I can't read, y'all. I lost my place. I'm getting new glasses next week, I promise. All right, so I got excited, y'all. I got excited. Anyway, while he was still speaking, a bright light enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." While disciples heard this, they fell face down on the ground, terrified. But Jesus came up and touched them. "Get up," he said. "Don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. I love this story, that Jesus would gather his close friends, and in this story, Peter gets ahead of himself, and he looks at Jesus as, "Oh, Jesus, it is good for us to be here." I love that. He says, "It's good to be here." And it is good to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to be adjacent to Jesus. And we should not forsake the gathering of the congregation. And again, I totally get this time of year, man, we have people that are struggling with sickness, and you should take care of yourself. You should isolate. You should quarantine. Those are just smart. That's just wise, right? But I know the media uses that word social distancing, and I don't like it. I understand physical distancing, but social distancing, we are social creatures. Matter of fact, in Genesis, the first time that God says it's not good, when he says it's not good that man's alone, right? We are made together. We're made for community. One of the most precious things he gave us was the church. And it's always bothered me. And if you've ever been out knocking on doors, I've been out knocking on cold call and talking to people that maybe have not been to church in a while. Inevitably, you'll get to someone and go, well, preacher, I listen to Adrian Rogers every morning. I'm like, well, that's good. Well, that David Jeremiah's got it right. Yeah, that's good. I listen to them during the week. I really do. I'm not against listening to that. But sitting alone in a house and watching a preacher is not church. Now, again, sometimes if that's all you can do, bless it. Reach out, call, and again, I don't want to take jabs. That's not what I'm doing here. But for especially some of those, it wasn't about physical. It wasn't about limitations or I can't. It's just like, you know what? I got mad at that church down there, and I just thought I could worship right here in my own house, and I can watch those. And let me be clear. Brother Corey is a fantastic pastor. I've not served under the preaching that I love his preaching. And we have some phenomenal teachers, and that's good. But let's be honest. If you have the internet, you can get better teaching. I'll just be honest. You're sitting here today listening to me. There are better teachers and preachers out there. Better communicators. Man, that's all they do. They work up two sermons a whole month, and they polish and they recorded about 10 times, and they pick the best one out of the 10. You know, and you can listen to some fantastic preachers and communicators, but can you do church? Church is together in community. And that's been one of the hardest hurdles through this pandemic is that the gospel is personal. It's one-on-one. It's seeing the hurt and the excitement and those that you sit and close to and actually feeling their pain and doing life together. That's together. And God's word says if two are walking alongside, one falls in a ditch, one can lift him up and help him. A cord of three cannot be easily broken. We're made to be together. Together is good. So if you're not together today, I want to encourage you to find ways, be creative, be smart, be careful. But don't miss together. Together is what we're made for. Together is good. Together is good. My next point is, what's better? What's better? And we have here in Luke chapter 10, if you have your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 10, 38. I love this story. Because together wasn't enough here. We get into better. Luke chapter 10, 38 says, and Jesus and his disciples were on their way. He came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She said she had a sister called Mary who sat by the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked him, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work all by myself? Tell her to get up. Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you're worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better. Everybody say better. Better. And it will not be taken away from her. I love that story. Because both were adjacent. All three were together. But one got it. One decided, I'm not going to be distracted. And I'm the distractor. I'm quite ADD. Way before we didn't have pills. We had Beat the Child Good when I was a kid. So I was ADD. I wasn't hyperactive, but I was the man. The teachers hate him. He's so sweet. He won't do it. He won't. I can't make him understand. So I was. They tried so hard, so hard. I had some great teachers, and bless their heart. If I had to sit down by myself in front of a computer all day, I would have made it. So bless our youth and children that have to do that. But I love that one. I'm easily distracted, and here's one is distracted, and there are days I feel like that I'm arranging the chairs on the Titanic. Do you understand what I'm saying? Right? I'm running around. I'm straightening. If you know me, I'm a straightener. It's a sickness. There's a few things I have OCD about, and that's, you know, I'm a little OCD about a few things. And they used to laugh at me. Our last church, we had chairs in the youth department that were color-coded. And they were like papasan chairs, and there was like a silver one, a black one, and a white one. And then somebody had gone out and bought a few like wild color orange and whatever. But it bothered me. When everybody left, I'm in there, and I had to make a pattern. And they would laugh at me. Brother Danny, they don't care. I care. It's one brown, one. It's like, oh, it's all pretty. You know, like, and then they'd come and mess it up. It's okay. I'd rearrange the chairs. And one day, honest to goodness, I was in there and I was arranging a chair, and I heard a youth say, Brother Danny, can I talk to you? Can I talk to you? And in my head was, give me 1 second. I got three more chairs. Yeah, I was like, that's one, because I'm a man, right? Come on, guys. Can I get a shout out? We like to do a job, finish a job. Don't interrupt me until I finish my job. And I was in my job. I was in my man. I was fixing something, and I'm doing it, and you're distracting me. And I was literally, I was like holding on to a chair, and they said, and they, can I talk to you? And I had to pry my hands off the chair. I said, I got all the time you need. What do you need? And I turned around. I sat down in that chair that wasn't straight and was in wrong order. And I said, this is what I'm here for. And many times we get distracted by things that are not bad. It's not wrong for us to straighten chairs. It's not wrong for us to do things. But sometimes a good thing can become a God thing. We place too much emphasis on it, and we get our priorities out of whack. As a parent, I find myself snapping back at my children. when there's a moment, a teachable moment, they ask me a question, and I'm in my man head, and I'm doing a job, and I want to throw out a sarcastic answer that will shut them down so I can finish my job. And I can miss that moment. I can miss something that's even better, that he said that will not be taken away from me. The moment I can look at my sons and say, that's a good question, and I can actually unravel and get to the heart of what's going on, and I can put aside the distractions, and I can be invested in the moment, and I can make first things first, because people are first, not things, not tasks. See, it's more important about the who, not the do. The older I get, I remember as a youth minister early on, and I plan out, it's been hard for me, y'all. If you knew when I came here, I landed out a year's calendar of events. You're like, really? You're going to do it? We're going to do all of that. It's all methodical. It's all planned out. We're going to do it. And I still kind of am wired that way. I like Corona's kind of throwing me for a loop, but this is kind of what we do. But I've learned some throughout the years. I love it when a youth group says, instead of, what are we doing tonight, Brother Danny? And they say, who's going to be there? See, it's more important about the who than the do. When my wife says, so what are we doing this weekend? Husbands, the correct answer is, it doesn't matter so long as I'm with you. You can use that. Patent pending. It doesn't matter so long as I'm with you. That should be the right answer. That should be the right answer with your children. What are we doing? It doesn't matter so long as I'm with you. Really? We used to laugh as they said, teenagers would show up and watch the paint peel if they're together. I love it. What are you doing? How many college students took a road trip? I remember just thinking, you know, have you ever done a road trip? It's the most crazy, bizarre thing. It doesn't make any sense to parents for the most part. But I had a friend in college that decided that they were going to go to the beach. We're going to drive 7.5 hours. They drove overnight, drove down to the beach, make every parent cringe to think about this. Two guys drove down to the beach, spent the day on the beach, bought a Coca-Cola in a glass bottle, sat on the hood of their car, watched the sun go down, washed out the bottle, filled it full of sand, capped it, took it home, drove home. And to the day he moved out of college, he said, that's my happiest memory. He had a Coke bottle, half filled with sand. He said, because I traveled with my best friend that passed away the next year. I wouldn't take anything for that bottle. See, it's about the who, not the do. Don't remember a thing what we did. I remember seeing the sunset, filling up the bottle, and it's a memory I will take with me forever because of the who, not what I did. Doesn't matter what I did. It matters who I did it with. So together is good. Invested is better. And it won't be taken from you. And lastly, is what's best? What's best? In our children's sermon this morning, we talked about that. What's best is being all in. Yesterday, as I stood in front of a crowd of people, and I asked two people to take vows and exchange rings and say I do, I looked at him, I said, look here, this is for real. There's no backing out. We all kind of chuckled. I said, this is your chance. If you're going to leave, leave now, because once we do this, this is forever. And they smiled, so we want to do it. We want to do it. I'm not backing out. I'm all in. That's a good answer. And everybody kind of giggled. But it's true. Are you all in? I love in this passage in Daniel chapter 3, he says, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the fiery furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it. And if he rescues us from your hand, O king, great. But even if he does not, We want you to know, O King, that we will not serve your God or worship the image of gold you have set up. These are three guys that were all in. They didn't have a backup plan. They weren't content just to be adjacent or together or even invested. They were all in. They had no backup plan. I used to think when I was a kid, I wondered if all three guys stand there and one guy steps forward and says, we want you to know. And they're like, yeah, yeah. And he goes, and even if he doesn't, wait, what? No, even if he doesn't, say, but you said he was going to deliver us. Yeah, wait, I've got a point here. He can deliver me from the king, even if it's deliverance into eternity with God. I'm not backing down. I'm not backing up. I don't have a backup plan. This is it. I'm all in. And I feel like God's looking at us today saying, I'm your coach, and I see the big picture, and I need you to trust me. I need you to be together. I need you to be invested. I need you all in. I don't need you looking up and going, but, no, 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 head down. If you see me do this, I want you to go with all you've got. No looking back, no holding on, no backup plan. I'm all in. Me and Miss Stephanie, earlier on, we were talking, we were laughing when we first got married. And I heard a man in our church say this. I just never forget. So one day I smiled, grinned at her, and I said, I just want you to know, if you leave me someday, I'm coming with you. There's no getting out of this. I'm in for the long haul. There's no options. I'm in. There's no backup plan. God was looking and said, I'm worth it. I'm the good father. I made together. I desire investment. I need you to trust me and be all in. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Father God, there are those here this morning that enjoy together. And I'm so thankful, Father, you made us four together. Father, I pray that you would help them make the next step. Maybe invest. Maybe realize we've been distracted by a few things. Take us to the next step. Help us do what's better. And to sit at your feet and really, really kind of be invested in you and step in. But Father, the home run, the best, is sold out. Saying I'm all in. I'm all in. Win, lose, or draw. I'm yours. This world comes crashing down. All I'm looking for is a coach's smile on his face saying, you did great. The world thinks I failed. The world thinks I wasn't successful. The world, it doesn't matter. You listen to me. Great job. Attaboy. You're my girl. You're my boy. I love you so much. You're doing a great job. Father, may I live my life for an audience of one. Father, thank you so much. Give us the courage today. Take that step towards you. In your name, amen. If you would please stand and sing with us. The altars are open. We'd be glad to talk to you.
A cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide, and it's great.
Bow your heads and close your eyes where you are. If you feel a way,
feel separated. And you're feeling the longing to be connected today. Know that you're not alone. I love this song. There's room. There's always room. It's never too late. You can come to know a Father who loves you. I want to pray with you. If you keep your head bowed, and Devin's going to sing through the last verse by himself. If no one comes, we're going to close out. But let me pray with you real quick. Father God, there are needs in this room. There are heavy burdens that need to be laid at your feet. There are those there, although they're in a crowded room today, Father, they feel alone and they don't have to be. You made together. You made us to be connected with those around us. Father, I lift up those in our church family that are they have to be separate for the time being. It's smart, it's wise, Father. And we lift them up in prayer. We ask that you just put your loving arms around them and encourage them today. And remind them that they are not alone. Father, I pray that you would remind us what's best. Father, if there's someone here today that's been kind of in the background and been kind of waiting around and just kind of checking things out, Father, I pray that today will be their first step. So you know what? I'm tired of waiting. I'm tired of looking over my shoulder to see. I wonder if I can make it. I wonder how this is going to work out. I just want to be all in. I want to be sold out for Jesus. I want to run for an audience of one. I'm tired of feeling like I'm constantly messing up. I want to make you smile today. Father, I pray that you give them the courage today. Maybe for the first time. Father, I pray for those that will come and pray for those that will not, but just encourage us in that. We love you, Jesus.
The hand of my Savior is strong, and the love of my Savior is long. Through sunshine or rain, through loss or in gain, the blood flows from
with me.
There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for, am I on? Kind of. Yeah. Thank you so much for being here today. Thank you for being together. Those that can, don't take that for granted. There are many that are joining us today that cannot be together, and they would say the same. Don't take it for granted. Be careful. Be smart. Be wise. Be healthy. But don't take that for granted. Don't. Not for a second. So thank you so much for being here. Any words before we dismiss in prayer? If I haven't told you lately, I love you. Appreciate you. Thank you for being so good to me and our family. And please keep Brother Corey in your prayers. My family has some sickness in there. I'll just leave it at that. If you would pray for my family, I'd appreciate that. And as we traverse the days ahead, that we would be wise and careful and smart. Again, next Sunday, don't forget, make plans to come eat a little, laugh a little, be together, socially careful. Anyway, come join us. Come join us. So that's what I've got. Anyone else before we dismiss in prayer? Yes, ma'am. Amen. Amen. This is good. All right. All minds clear. Going once. Going twice. Brother Darren Kemp, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer?